Good morning. Let me thank everybody for being here. And I want to start by reading the AFL-CIO Code of Conduct, which is also printed out on the cards that you should have in front of you. And it reads as follows. The AFL-CIO is committed to providing an environment free from discrimination and harassment, regardless of an individual's race, ethnicity, religion, color, sex, age, national origin, sexual orientation, disability, gender identity or expression, ancestry, pregnancy, or any other characteristic prohibited by law. As such, the AFL-CIO will not tolerate discrimination, harassing, or otherwise unacceptable behavior in the workplace or at any of our activities, events, or meetings. We adopt the following code of conduct, and we expect everyone in the workplace and those that participate in any of our activities, events, or meetings to abide by it. Our designee for this meeting is Chris Neff, the Executive Assistant to the Secretary Treasurer. Chris, stand up so everybody can see you over here. If you see or experience something that you think is prohibited by the code, please let Chris know. And I got to tell you, long before Harvey Weinstein became a household name, we adopted this comprehensive code of conduct that goes beyond the law of the land and is read at every AFL-CIO event throughout the country. When we begin our union events with these important words, it's a very, very powerful signal that harassment and retaliation and discrimination won't be tolerated. And it helps to move the cultural change that we need at work and in all of our unions. And we're very, very proud of our executive council for having the foresight to adopt that about a year ago, year and a half ago. I'd also like to note that we have several of our presidents here. When I call your name, will you please stand? Jim Boland, Rick Leonard. Mark Dimenstein, and I don't know if he's back in the room. Mark actually fell on the way over and bummed his leg up, so we're taking care of that, but he's here. Gabrielle Kateris. Paul Rinaldi. Paul's here somewhere. There he is. Dave Durkee. Sarah Nelson. Lee Saunders. Lee's on his way over. And Randy Weingarten, president of AFC, Randy. We also have several other council members and officers of our unions. Will you please stand up? I know Elise is here, several other on the general board. Stand up so people can take a look at you. Thank you. Cindy, thank you. So this conversation that we're about to have, I can tell you, is long, long overdue. I'm extremely proud of and humbled by the courage of the women who are bringing this issue of sexual harassment to the forefront, including my sister and my partner, AFL-CIO Secretary Treasurer Liz Schuller. Liz. And I also want to thank our other partner, Tafari Gabray. Tafari, our Executive Vice President. And I want to recognize and thank the leaders of the labor movement who have joined us today that I read earlier, along with our incredible allies and partners who are leading this work and strengthening this important intersection of workers and women's and civil rights. Together, all of us, we can create an America where every single person can work free from sexual harassment. So that's why this meeting is so important. We need men and women working together to end sexual harassment in the workplace. And some of us are in positions of power to influence the culture in our organizations and our workplaces. And that's right, I want to acknowledge my privilege here today. See, I came from pretty humble beginnings, and I think I've worked pretty hard to get where I came from to where I am today. But there's no denying that I'm a white man in a position of power. And social and cultural norms have specifically enforced a benefit to people like me. When I go to work, I don't have to worry about someone touching me inappropriately or judging me by what I'm wearing. I don't have to live in fear of harassment or reprisal. When I speak with passion and conviction, no one calls me bossy. And let me assert another hard truth. Labor's been part of the problem. See, sexism and misogyny in our ranks has been tolerated for far too long. Some of you have personally experienced it. The looks, the comments, the innuendo. See, this old boys club mentality must die, and it really must die today. Here's the good news. Thanks. Here's the good news. Labor's also part of the solution. We're still the greatest force for social change in America. We can combat sexism with solidarity. We can tear down misogyny with movement building. And we can use our own contracts to discourage bad behavior and to punish bad actors. And that's exactly what we're focused on here today. And let me leave you with this. No worker. I don't care what you do, how high or how low the position is perceived. No worker should be treated like a piece of property. No one should be touched or bullied or harassed or assaulted or discriminated against on the job. No worker. And we must do everything, and I mean everything in our power, to protect working people from sexism and misogyny and racism, xenophobia, transphobia, and homophobia. And we must hold abusers each and every one of them, accountable. See, every single person who lives and works in America has the right to do so safely. And we have a special responsibility to make that happen. So I'm here today as the leader of the AFL-CIO because stopping sexual harassment is both an institutional priority and a moral necessity. But let me tell you, our conscience on this issue is my friend and my partner, Secretary Treasurer Liz Schuller. I'm committed to listening to her and working with all of you to make the needed changes to end sexual harassment once and for all. Thank you for being here. It's an important day.